be here, and thank you to Justin for introducing me to the organization, as I was Phi Beta Kappa from Columbia. 1988, a proud year, was the only year in the history of college that never saw their football team win a game while they were there for 4 years. Very impressive. I'm also a proud Harvard Law School dropout. I went to law school briefly, actually it was the year behind Obama, but decided I did not want to pursue that, much like Cole Porter, another famous Harvard Law School dropout, and Robert Schumann, who left law school to become a musician. So I feel like I'm in good hands. And as Justin mentioned, I've lived in Baltimore now since 2013. I had started Amici Music while living in Asheville, North Carolina, before that. And I continue to go to Asheville every month, or at least I did until the pandemic, to do chamber music concerts, again, in people's homes and in bars. The idea of Amici Music, that's A-M-I-C-I, like friend, music among friends, is to present music in intimate places and non-traditional spaces, like bars and restaurants, to bring music out to many people. And as Justin mentioned, I really love to do the educational component. So I call it edutainment, both musical and educational, mostly classical, but lots of jazz kind of in interest as well. In fact, coming up in May, I'm doing a whole course on George Gershwin. And if you go to the website, amicimusic.org, you can sign up and come into my living room all the Thursdays in May, and I'll talk about the life and music of Gershwin. Also have a wonderful concert coming up on Mother's Day weekend of all women composers, piano trios by Clara Schumann and Louise Farenc and others. And all of that information, again, is on my website. But let me get to what we're going to talk about today. Justin wanted me to come up with an interesting topic, and I try to have my lectures related to the organization. So actually recently I did a lecture for a law firm out in California, and I did famous composers who had been lawyers, and that was kind of fun. But for this one, I thought we would do some Phi Beta Kappas, and I didn't know who was a Phi Beta Kappa. I did some research. There's several out there, so I want to do a sequel to this that will include Paul Robeson and Tom Lear, my favorite satirists of all time. But for this one, I thought I would start with the great Lenny Bernstein and Stephen Sondheim, who are intimately linked themselves because they worked on West Side Story together in 1957. But both are some of the smartest composers that America has ever seen. And it's not surprising to me now that I know that they were Phi Beta Kappas. So I'm going to start us off. I'm probably going to go over time because it's very difficult to get all this information in. But I'm going to try to stop after the Bernstein segment so that questions, you can ask questions, and then I'll get on to Sondheim. And I'm going to share my screen now. Hopefully it will all work. And move my guy over here. All right, so you should see in front of you my magnificent musical minds. I only like alliterative titles. Lenny Bernstein and Stephen Sondheim, Phi Beta Kappas. Here's Bernstein, born in 1918, dies in 1990. Phi Beta Kappa from Harvard in 1964. He actually graduated earlier than that from college, but must have gotten it later. I don't know how the Phi Beta Kappas work. And Sondheim, who was born in 1930 and is still alive, would be just celebrated his 90th birthday. His Phi Beta Kappa came from Williams College in 1952. Those of you who have been in my courses, you know that I love to collect quotes. And here's some of the wonderful quotes. So Lenny Bernstein said, this was a response to the Berlin Wall coming down. He said, "This will be our reply to violence, to make music more intensely, more beautifully, more devotedly than ever before. Only music can name the unnameable and communicate the unknowable." And at a time when we're really bashing liberals, he was a full-flung liberal and radical in his defense. He said, "A liberal is a man or a woman or a child who looks forward to a better day, a more tranquil night, and a bright, infinite future." And one of my favorite quotes, Bernstein said, "To achieve great things in life, two things are needed, a plan and not quite enough time." So true. Sondheim has some great quotes as well. He said, "Art in itself is an attempt to bring order out of chaos." And that certainly says it all. Sondheim was not a big fan of the mega musicals like Cats and Phantom of the Opera. He thought they were destroying Broadway. He said, "The dumbing down of the country reflects itself on Broadway. The shows get dumber and the public gets used to them." Sondheim really is an intellectual composer, and that's why some don't love his music, but really he gets at the essence of life, I think, with his lyrics and his music. He said, "I prefer neurotic people," and he definitely is one of those. "I like to hear rumblings beneath the surface." And finally, he's an avid crossword puzzle doer. Apparently, at all his shows, he's always doing crossword puzzles during rehearsals. And he said, "The nice thing about doing a crossword puzzle is you know there is a solution. And there's not always a solution to the musical problems." And I have a little bit of a conversation with Sondheim at the PBS NewsHour that I hope to play. Really intelligent man talking about his craft. But I want to start with Bernstein. Here he is in 1921 as a three-year-old boy with his parents, Samuel and Jenny. He actually was born with the name Louis Bernstein. That's what his grandmother wanted him called, and she refused to let him be called anything else, even though they always called him Lenny as a kid. Grew up in Lawrence, Massachusetts. His parents were both Jewish immigrants from the Ukraine. His father's original name was Shmuel Yosel. He had come over in 1908 and had started the Samuel Bernstein Hair Company, which was a very successful hair product store. In fact, he'd acquired the exclusive New England franchise for Frederick's Permanent Wave Machine. And apparently there was a huge rage for curly hair in the 1920s, so he got quite rich off of that. But he actually could have been richer. He knew Charles Revson, who went on to make Revlon Cosmetics. And he was going to go into business, but decided he didn't want to do it because he thought the red nail polish was too risque. So probably would have gotten even richer. But as I mentioned, known as Lenny, when his grandmother dies at the age of 15, he officially changes his name to Leonard Bernstein. And interestingly, he attended a well-known congregation synagogue in Boston, Mishkan Tefillah, and the musical director there was a guy named Solomon Braslavsky, who had come over from Russia, I believe, in the early 30s. Late 20s, early 30s. And Bernstein once wrote to him, he said, "I never forgot the tremendous influence that you and your music made on me when I was just a child. They surpass any that I have ever heard. The memories I have of your music are so bright, strong, and dear that I shall probably never be able to estimate the real influence those sounds exerted on me. Before I ever heard a concert, a recital, or an opera, before I had even touched a piano or knew that an organized musical life existed, before all these, I heard the music that Professor Braslavsky caused to be made at Temple Mishkan Tefillah. I shall never forget that music, nor cease to be grateful for the power, conviction, and atmosphere with which it was conveyed. I may have heard greater masterpieces performed since then and under more impressive circumstances, but I have never been more deeply moved. Braslavsky's music making will always be with me as a cherished memory and influence." This time at the synagogue, even though he was not a devoutly religious man, it really helped him with his musical understanding. His father was not a great fan of him going into music. In fact, he said that to his father, the word musician was a word like beggar, a person who comes around to weddings scraping on his fiddle and begging for a few kopecks. But it was actually his father who brought him to see some Boston Symphony and really got him excited. And ultimately, he would attend Barrison Grammar School, Boston Latin, and start studying piano at the New England Conservatory in 1931 with Helen Coates and Susan Williams. He often played four-hand piano versions of operas and symphonies with his younger sister, Shirley. He would attend Harvard from 1935 to 1939 and studied there with some well-known composers and pedagogues, Edward Burlingame Hill and Walter Piston. But his final thesis was a really great one called The Absorption of Race Elements into American Music. And that's when he explored how both Aaron Copland and George Gershwin were beginning to use the blues and jazz and other black music to produce a true new American sound. So one of the early essays, academic essays, about Gershwin and Copland and this new jazz style that was really taking over music. He actually met Copland in 1938 at a party and later described him as his only real composition teacher. And they were friends all through life. At Harvard, he mounted a student production of Mark Blitzstein's radical 1937 opera, The Cradle Will Rock, an allegory of corruption and corporate greed, and Blitzstein became friends with him. And then he also meets conductor Dmitri Mitropoulos, and he urges Bernstein to take up conducting and teaching. He recognizes that he's a natural talent as a pedagogue, and he begins studying conducting at Curtis Institute in Philly with Fritz Reiner, composition with Randall Thompson, piano with Isabel Vengerova. And here's a photo of Bernstein in 1944 by the great Carl Van Vechten. After Curtis, he actually ends up moving to New York, and he shares an apartment with playwright and lyricist Adolf Green, who they met at summer camp earlier on. And Green, along with his collaborator Betty Comden, would become very good friends. Together, they would all create On the Town in 1944, and then followed that up with Wonderful Town, another great musical that doesn't get done often, in 1953. And I'm going to play shortly a wedding present he gave to Adolf when he married a woman named Phyllis Green in 1960. They were very close all through life. He studied conducting with Serge Koussevitzky at the Boston Symphony Orchestra's newly created Tanglewood that was started right there in the 40s, would become his conducting assistant, and then ran the program when Koussevitzky died. And actually, I was at Leonard Bernstein's final performance at Tanglewood in the 90s when he did Beethoven's Seventh Symphony. He couldn't finish because he had a coughing fit, and that was sort of appropriate that he would sort of end his career at Tanglewood. He was assigned as assistant conductor of the New York Phil in 1943, and then a very famous concert took place on November 14th, 1943, where he had to substitute on only a few hours' notice with no rehearsal for a sick Bruno Walter, the main conductor, on a nationally broadcast concert. The New York Times carried the story. They said, "It's a great American success story. The warm, friendly triumph of it filled Carnegie Hall and spread far over the airwaves." And it was important. He was an American conductor taking over for a German in the middle of World War II. He would actually ultimately become the music director of the New York Philharmonic in 1958, the first American-born conductor to lead an American orchestra, which is really kind of amazing to think about. But all the conductors before this were Italian, like Toscanini, or mostly German. He really was the great American messiah in that way. Conducts in Israel in 1947 and was a really big part of the Israeli scene for many years. The first American who ever conducted at La Scala, the opera house in Milan, in 1953, and was a huge advocate of the composer Mahler, who at that point was not that well known, but Bernstein kept playing his major symphonies and really sparked a whole new interest. Also premiered many works by his good friend Copland. He would write his first symphony, Jeremiah, in 1943. What I want to do now is play a couple short pieces. He did not write a lot for piano, but I'm going to play a couple short ones. One is called from a set called Four Sabras that he wrote in 1950. Sabra is a Jew born in Israel, so it was sort of a new term. This one is called The Dreamer, a very beautiful, light little piece. And then I'm going to follow it up with a piece that he wrote for Adolf and Phyllis Green as a wedding present. You will recognize the tune. It's from Bach's C major prelude, but he puts his own little thing on top, just like Gounod had done with the Ave Maria in a little jazz thing. And the second piece I'm gonna play is actually written for two people at the piano, one playing just one hand because Phyllis was not a very good pianist. I'm gonna try to do it as if I have three hands, but I think it'll work. So enjoy first Elana the Dreamer, and then this present, the Bridal Suite. Let's see if I can get you in there. Thank you. That's a little present that he did for Adolph Green, a little play on Bach, who Bernstein always loved, wrote lots of wonderful lectures about him. All right, now let's get back to his life here. All right, so in 1951, he ends up marrying a an actress by the name of a Costa Rican-born actress named Felicia Montealegre. And there was lots of rumors at the time of his homosexuality. He definitely was homosexual, as Felicia later wrote in a memoir. She said, "He was a homosexual, he could not change, but if your peace of mind, your health, your whole nervous system depends on a certain sexual pattern, what can you do?" Arthur Lawrence, who wrote the book for West Side Story, said, "Bernstein was a gay man who got married. He wasn't conflicted about it at all, he was just gay." And Shirley Rhodes Pearl, another friend, said that she thought Bernstein required men sexually, but women for the emotional side. So there's lots of talk about it. The fact is they actually had a wonderful marriage together. They had three children, and then she would die in the 1970s of cancer. And the same year, he would conduct the premiere of Charles Ives' Second Symphony. What made that fascinating is that the piece had actually been written back at the end of the 19th century. Had not been played. It was such a modern piece of music. But Bernstein loved Ives, and the fact that Ives actually saw this premiere as an old man and just loved it. And so Bernstein really helped create Ives. Again, what we think of Ives, he was a forgotten guy, an insurance salesman, but Bernstein loved his music. It was way too modern for the early part of the 20th century, though. He would become visiting professor at Brandeis from 51 to 56, writes his first opera, Trouble in Tahiti, in 52, and then composed the score for the movie On the Waterfront in 1954, writes the operetta Candide in 1956, based on Voltaire's novella. The libretto was by Lillian Hellman, a famous writer, but it was not a very successful show, did not get a long run. Mostly people think that Hellman's libretto did not do the show justice. Here's one review said, where Voltaire is ironic and bland, Hellman is explicit and vigorous. Where he makes lightning rapier thrusts, she provides body blows. Where he is diabolical, she is humanitarian. The libretto just seems too serious for the verve and lyricism of Leonard Bernstein's score. So the score has kept on, and there are some wonderful moments in it, but the run didn't do well. But he does follow that up with his greatest success, and that was West Side Story in 1957, a huge hit on Broadway, working with choreographer Jerome Robbins, writer Arthur Lawrence, and ultimately a young Stephen Sondheim would come in to write the lyrics for the songs. Now, this show was something that he and Lawrence had talked about for a long time. In fact, originally they were gonna call it East Side Story, and it was gonna be a show about the Jews and the Irish Catholics on the east side of New York. But they decided that didn't quite work. They shelved the project for a while, and during the 1950s, a lot of the Puerto Ricans came into the west side of New York and were having fights with the Italians, and so it seemed perfect to do this updated revival of Romeo and Juliet in New York on the west side. But there were still people who said the show could never work. Here's what Bernstein said. "Everyone told us that West Side Story was an impossible project. They said the score was far too rangy for pop music. And besides, who wants to see a show in which the first act curtain comes down on two dead bodies lying on the stage? Then we had the really tough problem of casting the show, because the characters had to be able not only to sing, but to dance and act and be taken for teenagers. Ultimately, some of the cast were teenagers. Some were 21, some were 30, but they sure looked like they were 16. Some were wonderful singers, but they couldn't dance very well, or vice versa. And if they could do both, they couldn't act a lick." But somehow they came out with this magical show, West Side Story. And I wanna share with you, let's see if I can do it. Nope, I gotta come back here. What we're going to play now is a version of the West Side Story for violin and piano that was actually written for my colleague Tim Schwartz, who I play lots of concerts with, a wonderful violinist. His cousin, Lawrence Lavolsi, arranged West Side Story for us. We were chosen as the ambassadors of music back in 1996, and went all over the Middle East, places like Syria. We played in Aleppo, Syria, which was a beautiful place. It doesn't really exist now. We played in Pakistan and Egypt, Tunisia, lots of places that had revolution right after we left. So I don't know if that was the cause, but also Laos and Thailand, Sri Lanka. But we brought this piece wherever we went, and everyone, no matter where they were around the world, knew West Side Story, and they love this music. So I'm going to share it with you now, if I can find it. Hold on one sec. I've got to get out of here. Hold on. Here we go. All right, so here's West Side Story as arranged by Lawrence Lavolsi. I'm going to move my... Please tell me if it's too loud. Hopefully it's going to be the right volume. Oh, it's coming back. Where'd you go? Thank you. A little arrangement of West Side Story for violin and piano. Again, Timothy Schwartz on violin. That's here in my living room. The paintings on the back wall, by the way, are by my father. My late father died a few years back. He was actually a doctor, but had time to paint in his spare time. And he's just have all these paintings in my living room. So hopefully you can all come to this great room house in Guildford and see one of these live. I realize I'm getting way behind in time, but we got to keep going here. All right, now, what I love Lenny the most about was his educational talks, and probably many of you remember his Young People concerts. He actually started off doing this series called the Omnibus program for CBS TV. He was the first conductor to do live television programs and was just an incredible lecturer. And you can see some of these on YouTube. In fact, the one about his Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, it starts off with him explaining the symphony, and there were giant manuscripts that they had on the floor in Beethoven's own hand, all the orchestra musicians there. I mean, it's just a great way to teach music. He also did nine more of those on jazz and Bach and opera. But then in 1958, he started the Young People's Concert Series through the New York Philharmonic, which were just epic, great educational music. He published The Joy of Music, which is a fabulous book with a lot of his lectures in it in 1959, The Infinite Variety of Music in 1966. And then in 72, 73, he gave these six lectures at Harvard, known as The Unanswered Question, which was also the name of a Charles Ives symphony. And they were kind of interdisciplinary lectures, borrowing terminology from linguistics to analyze and compare musical construction to a language. And in fact, Noam Chomsky, the great linguist, later wrote, "I spent some time with Bernstein during the preparation and performance of the lectures. My feeling was that he was on to something, but I couldn't really judge how significant it was." And he really explained music in such a way that it wasn't this far-off esoteric thing. It was just a way to communicate. And that's what we try to do with Amici music, and I think all people should do with music. And of course, he would tour the Soviet Union, the first conductor of America to go there in 1959, conducted Shostakovich's Fifth Symphony while the composer was in the audience. So I have a couple of these lectures I want to share because one of them is just so good. This is it's on the YouTube as the greatest 5 minutes in the history of music education from his first Harvard lecture. And you'll get a sense of just how he could speak this language in such a wonderful way.
What we're trying for is a very high overview of musical development in terms of a vocabulary constantly being enriched by more and more remote and chromatic overtones. It's as if we could see the whole of music developing from prehistory to the present in 2 minutes. Now let's again pretend we're hominids and that the smash hit of the moment is, let's say, Fair Harvard. Here we are in our hominid hut crooning Fair Harvard. And now maybe our wives and maybe our prepubescent sons join in, and automatically we're singing not in unison but in octaves, since men's and women's voices are naturally an octave apart. Now that octave interval, I wish I could sing an octave so I could really show you what I mean. But that octave interval happens to be the first interval of the harmonic series, as you remember, right? Okay, now centuries pass, and the next interval of the harmonic series is assimilated by humanity, namely the fifth. And now we can be singing this. By those festival Now, of course, this little change brings us forward a mere 10 million years into the 10th century AD and into a fairly sophisticated musical culture. But now we admit the next interval of the series, the fourth, and now we can mix intervals of the octave and the fifth and the fourth. Beginning to sound like polyphony. And again comes a great leap as music absorbs the next overtone, the third, and just listen to the difference. It's a whole new music, richer, mellower, with a new coloristic warmth. And as we know, this new interval of the third, because I like the older sound better, but anyway, as we know, this new interval of the third introduces into music the phenomenon of the triad, so that now Fair Harvard can begin to sound more like its Victorian self. And so there is born what we now call tonal music, a stable tonal language firmly rooted in the basic notes of the harmonic series, the fundamental, its first different overtone, the fifth, now and forevermore to be known as the tonic and the dominant. And that fifth interval really does dominate, because once this tonic-dominant relationship is established, it's a field day for composers. There can now be fifths of fifths of fifths of fifths, each one of them a new tonic producing a new dominant, a whole circle of fifths. 12 of them, in fact, always winding up with the starting tone, whether proceeding upwards, let's say from the low C, G, D, A, E, B, F sharp, C sharp, G sharp, D sharp, E flat, F, C. That's again C, believe it or not. Or proceeding downward, starting from that, C, F, B flat, E flat, A flat, G flat, E flat, E. God say, C. See, that's a circle of 12 fifths, and that's the answer I promised you. That's how we get the 12 different tones of our chromatic scale. In other words, if you take all those 12 of the circle of fifths and put them together in scale order, you'll get this. And what's more, those 12 notes generate a circle of 12 keys through which, thanks to the perfecting of the temperate system, composers can now go freewheeling at their own chromatic pleasure. Now, this means that ultimately, Fair Harvard can sound like this. that's chromatic porridge. And in our own century, it's going to become goulash. How does music contain this loose, runny chromaticism? By the basic principle of diatonicism, that stable relationship of tonics and dominant, subdominant, and supertonic, and new dominant, and new tonics. We can now modulate as freely as we want, as chromatically as we want, and still have complete tonal control.
So that's Bernstein just showing his ability to break down things that take like a whole semester to talk about if you do a sort of a fundamentals of music class in 5 minutes, really a fast-paced thing. And I wanted to show one of his young people's concerts where he really talks about Beethoven as a composer, as freeing music in so many ways, just the political side of Bernstein coming out here.
The truth is that all great composers free music, not from the bondage of other composers, but from routine, from mediocrity, from second-rate, dusty tradition. In other words, a great composer frees music from the predictable. Now take one of Beethoven's most obvious examples of the unpredictable, the famous opening tune of his third symphony, the Eroica. Now you know that tune. It rides along in E flat major on the nice expected notes of the tonic triad. And it goes like that for four bars on just those notes. And then on the fifth bar, the unexpected happens. So the tune goes like this. Bang, that D flat, surprise. A bondage of the triad is broken. Music is freed, but freed by what? By a D flat, and that's just the point. It's a D flat, not a C flat, not an A natural, but that one chosen limited note, D flat. That's what did the freeing. Now, doesn't this tell us something very important about the nature of freedom? Obviously, freedom must carry with it the meaning of freedom to limit oneself and one's material. Freedom is not infinite, not boundless liberty, as some hippies like to think. Do anything you want, anytime, anywhere you want to. No, freedom isn't that. It means being free to make decisions, to determine one's own course. But decisions, deciding, means choosing. And choosing is impossible without rejecting. Now, can you understand that? You can't choose something without rejecting all the other things you haven't chosen. You see? If you choose one apple out of a dozen, you automatically unchoose the other 11. And if Beethoven chose that one D flat, he automatically unchose all the other 11 notes. So you see, real freedom must contain within itself the freedom to unchoose as well as choose, to censor oneself, to limit oneself. And that is the whole meaning of democracy, the kind of freedom on which we base our hopes for a peaceful world, just as it is the meaning of freedom in great musical composition. In Beethoven, as in democracy, freedom is a discipline combining the right to choose freely with the gift of choosing wisely. Now do you see what I meant by Beethoven's shaping of that movement? I hope so. End of lecture. Now we're going to hear more of that great free...
So there's his young people's concerts and just explaining what it is that freedom really means in Beethoven. Getting back, I don't know if I'm gonna have time to do Sondheim, but hopefully you guys don't mind doing a little bit longer. Here's Bernstein was a huge liberal activist, always outspoken, saw music as a vehicle towards social change. He was blacklisted for a time by the US State Department for his communist leanings in 1950s, but unlike others, he didn't have to testify before the House Un-American Activities Committee. If we stick around and we do Paul Robeson, there's an incredible video of him at the HUAC committee, just ripping apart these senators with just incredible intelligence. But Bernstein didn't have to do that. After JFK was assassinated, he conducted Mahler's Resurrection Symphony in a nationally televised memorial, and then followed it up with his Kaddish Symphony, which was dedicated to JFK and to peace everywhere in the world. There was a famous party that took place at his Park Avenue apartment in 1970 to raise money for the Black Panther Party, who had just been, several members had been arrested, and they were trying to raise money for the Legal Defense Fund. But there was a sort of a nasty article, a satirical article that Tom Wolfe wrote in New York Magazine entitled Radical Chic, That Party at Lenny's, which sort of was the first time that term had been used as these kind of white liberals sort of playing around with radicalness when that's when they're at their Park Avenue apartment. But Lenny and his wife were very active, and that was sort of a mean article. On Christmas 1989, Bernstein conducts Beethoven's Symphony No. 9 in East Berlin's Schauspielhaus, part of a celebration of the fall of the Berlin Wall, had just conducted the same work in West Berlin the previous day. That concert was broadcast live in more than 20 countries with an estimated audience of 100 million people. And for that, they changed the famous Ode to Joy to Ode to Freedom, Freiheit. He said, I am sure that Beethoven would have given us his blessing. Finally, just a few more great quotes by Lenny. He said, I sometimes think that man's capacity for laughter is nobler than his divine gift of suffering. Laughing cleanses a man. It restores his sanity and balances his sense of values. Then he said, development is really the main thing in life, just as it is in music, because development means change, growing, blossoming out. And these things are life itself. He said, inspiration is wonderful when it happens, but the writer must develop an approach for the rest of the time. And this is a beautiful quote. He said, I think it is time we learn the lesson of our century, that the progress of the human spirit must keep pace with technological and scientific progress, or that spirit will die. It is incumbent on our educators to remember this. And music is at the top of the spiritual must list. When the study of the arts leads to the adoration of the formula, heaven forbid, we shall be lost. But as long as we insist on maintaining artistic vitality, we are able to hope in man. And his final quote, it's the artists of the world, the feelers and thinkers who will ultimately save us, who can articulate, educate, defy, insist, sing, and shout the big dreams. I want to go out for this part and then I can take some questions with a short little piece that Lenny wrote for Stephen Sondheim. Bernstein would write these one-page kind of birthday gifts or anniversary gifts for his friends. And he writes this for Sondheim's 35th birthday. So I thought it would sort of bring us into the Sondheim world. I'll take questions about Bernstein, although I do have some more to talk about for Sondheim if you want to stick around. Here's this little piece by Bernstein. So if there's a couple questions you want to have now, and what time is it? Oh, it's already an hour. I don't know. Should I stop or should I go on with Sondheim? I feel like I have so much to say, but it's up to you.
Why don't you go on to Sondheim and then you can do some questions at the end. Is that okay, Pam? Okay.
Well, what I'm wondering if Daniel, it sounds like if you're going to be another hour on Sondheim, should we have questions now and then we can reschedule the Sondheim maybe in June? Would that be acceptable to people? Just wave your hand or whatever, since it's virtually 8 o'clock now. And this has been so fabulous so far. And I don't want to lose people who might be hungry.
It is getting late. It always takes longer. I'm happy to come back and do another one in June. I'm going to be going away in the middle of June, but if there was something early on, I would love to do that.
Or later in June. Depending on what your schedule, we'll talk about your schedule.
Talk about it, but if it might be that, because it's probably going to be another 45 to an hour on Sondheim, so it always takes a lot longer than I think. So I probably should have just covered one person on these lectures.
Yeah. And my thought is, my husband and I really love Sondheim, so I would not want people to miss, such an incredible person. If that's amenable to you, am I sort of raise your hands if you all agree? Yep, I'm seeing so far, I haven't seen everybody. It looks like everybody is raising their hand. So we have a board meeting in May 30th, and we'll talk about another date and either do it before or after your vacation, because this has been very, very special. Yeah. So let's take questions.
I have a comment, if it's okay. Can you hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I just want to recommend to you an article that was in the American Scholar in winter, not the current issue, but the one before. It's by Joseph Horowitz, and it is an article that mentions Bernstein, going back in history to what the U.S. could have been in terms of the arts. And he discusses Bernstein's trip to Russia. And in there, he talks about Bernstein being a little bit of a loose cannon.
That he was.
I wondered if you could comment more on his personality. He describes him as free-spirited, irrepressible, extolled American music and critiqued Soviet restraints. And one of the things he did was added Charles Ives' The Unanswered Question to his program, which had not been scheduled.
In Russia?
Yes.
Yeah, I didn't realize that. Yeah, he was not an easy person to get along with by any means. And he was freewheeling with his sexual life and all those innuendos out there. But it was all for the purpose that he loved music and he wanted to bring all kinds of music to people. And he just hated the idea of repressing any kind of music. And so it's not surprising to me that he would sort of fight the Soviet system. He fought the Nazi system and his love of American music. He wasn't crazy out there with the modern stuff, but he loved Ives. He loved Copland. And he thought it was his mission to make sure that people understood there was great stuff coming out of America, not just himself as a conductor, but so many other composers. So it's an interesting story to think what might have happened. I mean, if we had been able to continue these kind of young people's concerts, we might have had a whole new generation of people, young people who understood classical music. But sadly, as the classical and popular music really began to break apart after Lenny in the 70s and 80s, so that, most young people, it's really difficult. They love classical music if you play it for them, but they don't hear it. And there's not a lot of great education being done. I'm trying to do it. I have a program that's called Beethoven Lives in Baltimore, where I dress up as Beethoven and go into schools. But it's very difficult the way that society is sort of set up with the internet now. And we can only hope that classical music can keep going, but without Lenny, it's difficult. Question.
I was just wondering if you might comment, because a couple times you talked about earlier in the presentation his relationship with incorporation of roots music, let's say. So like as the 60s went on into the 70s, what was Bernstein's take on the development of jazz? I mean, so much happened in his lifetime. Did he stay as an outsider, or did he comment on that? What are your
He loved modern jazz, and he was a big fan of all the Miles Davis and those guys who were coming out there. No, he thought that he understood that it started with the blues and the jazz coming out of there, and how American composers took that, like Gershwin and Copland. But I think he was always living in those two worlds. Obviously, West Side Story was coming out of Latin kind of music. He did not believe that there was a classical music and a popular music. For him, music was just music. It was a continuum. And if he happened to be going to a jazz club, he would do that. And he does have moments of the blues that he puts into his music at all times. And sometimes very modern sounding music that he writes. Very different tones. As he said in the video, he doesn't like tonal harmony. You don't hear a lot of that kind of stuff in Bernstein. He loved the sound of the fourths and fifths, which were really a part of jazz as well. So I think Bernstein would have made a much better jazz person in many ways than a classical, but he was trying to fuse those worlds in a way that only Gershwin probably before him did successfully. But Bernstein as an educator was probably the most successful at bridging the world, all the different worlds of music that were around during his life.
I have two questions. First one deals with the mass.
Yeah.
I think, you know, there is certainly a lot of discussion, somebody writing the mass who was Jewish. I'm not sure that he was a very strong practicing Jew, or maybe you can comment on that. No, but yeah. I know, can you talk a little bit about some of the discussion about when he wrote the mass and how there was discussion about him as a Jew writing the mass?
Yeah, and again, I think it's the same idea that he went into music. He thought religion was all religion. And so it seemed appropriate. Obviously, he went to synagogue as a kid. We saw how it influenced him. He wasn't an active a Jewish person in terms of going to temple, but he believed in the faith and he was a big supporter of Israel, of course. But to him, I believe religion was, again, a continuum. And we just needed to have spirit. We had to have faith in peace. He was a huge believer in peace, in love, in tolerance. And so for him, the mass was just a way of showing that aspect of religion, not the Jesus aspect, but the mass as bringing people together as a way of communicating. And yes, there was a lot of talk when that came out. I can't remember exactly when early 90s, I think, that people said, how can a Jewish guy write a mass? It doesn't work. And some of the Christian people, the fundamentalists, didn't want to listen to it because it was by a Jewish guy. It's similar, actually. I don't have them up here, but my father, who grew up Jewish, he did a lot of Holocaust imagery, but with as if it was Jesus on the cross, and he managed to upset just about everybody, Jews and Christians alike. And I think Lenny would have been happy if he upset people if they just didn't understand his message, which was that we needed to bridge gaps to build community and not to worry about sectarian sense in any way.
And my second question is, could you talk a little bit as sort of a bridge to our next program about his relationship with Sondheim?
Yeah, so they were close friends. Sondheim shows up in 1957 to write these lyrics. And as we'll see next week, Bernstein actually wanted to offer him a 2% commission, which would have been a split with what he had. Sondheim only said, no, I only want one, I'm young. And then he regretted that for the rest of his life because so much money could have been made. But they ended up maintaining this friendship all through life. Bernstein would show up at the Sondheim galas. They went in different directions. Sondheim really focused only on writing musicals, was not a conductor in the sense, but Sondheim was much more really a novelist. I mean, he actually could win a Pulitzer Prize for his just his words. He was not certainly an active educator. He also was a thorny guy who had a very difficult childhood, was neurotically messed up by his mother and father, mostly by his mother. We'll see a lot of how he really reinvented the American musical, made it a more internal, introspective thing. He was not a showman like Bernstein was, but they maintained a friendship right until the end when Lenny dies in 2000, I guess. Hopefully you'll get to see all of that. For Sondheim, I won't get to play as much because he didn't really write for piano. There is one thing I'm going to play for him, but mostly his incredible songs and people like Patti LuPone and Bernadette Peters who make this music come alive that you almost, when you listen to it, it's hard not to cry. The emotions are so raw in his music. And he also was, as I mentioned, a brilliant talk He could talk about his craft so well. And there's a great talk that he does within the PBS NewsHour, which I could watch over and over. It's, you don't see people with that sort of intelligence. And that's, again, that Phi Beta Kappa thing. He was an incredibly smart guy. And it shows in the way he writes his music.
Yeah, he was in the news this week, in fact. Are there any other questions? Before we end, my guess is that Bernstein was given an honorary Phi Beta Kappa. He was inducted because it was 1964. And for those of us who are from Maryland and know Robert Meyerhoff, the University of Maryland, Baltimore gave him an honorary Phi Beta Kappa key and inducted him as an honorary member. So since it was so long after Leonard Bernstein's graduation, my guess is that he was probably inducted as an honorary member.
That's what I would assume. And before you go, I also want to just mention again, check out amicimusic.org, A-M-I-C-I music. Great Gershwin course starts next Thursday. And then I hope you can join me on Mother's Day weekend. Some of this music by women composers is just ungodly beautiful. It's with Francis and Emmanuel Borofsky, violin and cello and piano. We're just recording some of it this morning, and then we'll record some tomorrow. But pieces that you probably have never heard that should be heard by a lot of neglected women composers who really struggle to get their voices heard. And I'll hopefully be back with you guys either on this kind of format, or maybe by the time we do it, it'll be in my house. But I'd love for you to hear about Sondheim and then Paul Robeson and Tom Lear, too, who are my favorite satirists as well. But I want to thank Justin for inviting me and all of you for having me on the Zoom.
Well, Daniel, we will look forward to getting back to you for Sondheim, because as I said, my husband and I are great aficionados of him. And Justin, thank you so much for connecting us to Daniel. This is a great treat for Phi Beta Kappa. And in the past, we've had a few musical programs, but we haven't had any for a while, and not during Zoom till this. So thank you so much. It was a real treat for all of us as members. And
it's been great. It's been great.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So remember, when we come up with the next date, I hope everybody will come back. And I just want to remind everyone of our next Phi Beta Kappa program, which is May 12th at 7 p.m. And it's the issue of criminal justice and how it penalizes poverty. And our speaker is Catherine Fry Balter from the University of Maryland School of Law. And I think this is such an important issue that we have been dealing with, whether it's not just bail reform, it's lots of things that are going on. And as all of us are looking at what has been going on in our country in for centuries, but certainly it has now been brought to the forefront, I think this is a very important program for all of us to take advantage of. So Daniel, thank you. Thank you to all of you who participated. And we will get back to you with Sondheim.
Thank you. Thanks for being
here. Thanks very much. Bye, everyone.
Have a great night.
Thank you, Dan. Thanks again. It was wonderful.
Okay, good night.
Good night.
Good night. And thank you.
You're most welcome. Thank you, Justin.
Yeah. I pointed out in the chat, although I've never done it, your courses are similar in format to this, right? Between recorded material discussion. And I think because there was at least a couple comments that people really like the format. I mean, it's for Zoom, and I teach on Zoom every day.
Yeah,
it's miserable, but this is optimal.
That's been the weird thing about the pandemic. It's like the best thing for my career, because I love this is like the best way to do things, and it's the only thing that works on Zoom, because I can't watch other stuff on Zoom. But I think this is fun, and you sort of break up the thing.
Yeah, well, because if I lecture for an hour, I've lost all of them. I mean, in classrooms I still do anyway, but on Zoom. But having the transition from slides to music to talking, I mean, it really does work pretty well. So
great. I'm glad about that. Well, hopefully I'll see some people at the course, and I'll see you back for Sondheim whenever we can work it out. Take care, everyone.
I'm hoping for in person. That's my hope.
I hope it works. Good night, all.
All right. Thanks, everybody.